And Paul says, absolutely yes, because they believe in the Messiah as we do. We have been crucified and raised with Christ, therefore we're all part of the Christ family. And some people say, oh, you're substituting ecclesiology for soteriology. No, of course this fits into a larger soteriology, but Paul's concern is that the church is to be one church, and his concern for church unity is in every single letter he writes. And we in the modern West, especially the Protestant West, have always tried to play that down because we are frightened of being told that the church ought to be united in case that means that we were wrong to have a reformation or something like that. And I'll say, no, we needed a reformation, that's fine. But now we have to pay attention to what Paul says about church unity. Yes. And that is massive in every letter he writes. And justification and church unity actually belong together. So there are all sorts of issues like this where I want to say, I value Luther and Calvin. They were great men. They were doing a fantastic job for their time. But they themselves would say, please don't be a Lutheran or a Calvinist in that sense. Please go back to the Bible itself and find out what it meant in its original context. And so it's a historical movement. The problem is that Sanders and others who followed Sanders have tried to pull away from the theology and just do sociology. And I've tried to explain in my books that's not what I'm doing. So there are many different versions of the so-called new perspective. Mm-hmm. And I want to say to people, please don't lump all these together as if they're the same thing, because they're really not.
Yes, thank you. So is it right to say that Paul was not a Christian, but a Jewish follower of Christ?
Somebody wrote a book recently, Paul was not a Christian. It was
Pamela, right?
Pamela Eisenbaum.
Yeah.
And my response to that was, no, and Moses wasn't a Jew either, because actually Moses was not from the tribe of Judah. Moses was from the tribe of Levi, of course, he and Aaron were. And so, historically, we don't actually know how widespread the word Christian was in the first century, but that's not the point. The point is the word Christian has acquired all sorts of baggage later on, and Paul is not involved in that later baggage. But Paul's self-description is, I am a man en Christo, and in Christ. And I think if we'd said to Paul, are you a Christian or a Jew? He would say, I am a follower of Jesus, who is the Messiah, the Christ, and he is the fulfillment of the hope of Israel. So Paul would say he, Paul, is a Jew in every possible sense, and that Jesus is the Messiah who God promised to Israel. This is the point. When people say, was Paul a Christian or a Jew, they are implying that what's really going on is a comparison between two types of religion. That's not the point. Paul is not doing comparative religion. He's not saying Christianity is better than Judaism or something silly like that. He's saying Jesus is Israel's Messiah and therefore the world's true Lord. Yeah. That's the key thing.
Yeah, and I think sometime a few years ago, Christian Sindel, if I'm not wrong, he says his name.
Yes.
Paul was not converted.
Yeah,
so
well,
what do you want to comment
again,
there?
It depends what you mean. What Stendhal meant, and I did know Stendhal a bit, he was a great man, actually. I have a lot of respect for him. Mm. He was able to think outside the box in very helpful ways. He was worried that people were saying that Paul started off as a Jew, that meant he was self-righteous, it meant he thought he had to do good works to go to heaven, and then he was converted, so he gave up being a Jew and became a Christian instead. And Stendhal, I think, was quite right to say when Paul met Jesus on the road to Damascus, he understood this as the true revelation of the God he had always worshipped. So it's not a conversion from one religion to another. And again, our word conversion doesn't really address the issue which is going on in the first century, that for Paul, and Paul says when he's before the Sanhedrin in the book of Acts, he says, all my life I have worshipped God with a clear conscience, the God of our ancestors, and the God of our ancestors now acted in Jesus, and I'm going with that. So what we then mean by conversion, abandoning one religion and taking up another, is clearly not what happened. However, Paul clearly did believe that something radical had happened in him, that the Holy Spirit had worked in him, and that there was, he saw this as the fulfillment of Deuteronomy 30, of Jeremiah, of Ezekiel, and so But again, this is the hope of Israel.
That's right.
So, but he says the hope of Israel has now come to birth, and it's come to birth in me. So if that's what you mean by conversion, then yes, Paul was converted. But this is our problem with our modern meanings of conversion. I do address this in chapter 15 of Paul and the Faithfulness of God.
Thank you.
It's good, good.
And I quote your statement here, quite impressive. For too long we have read scripture with 19th century eyes and 16th century equations.
Yeah, yeah.
It is time that we get back to reading scripture with 1st century eyes and 21st century equations.
Yeah, yeah,
it's quite impressive. And can you clarify what you mean by this statement?
Yeah. I mean, I grew up in a very ordinary English Christian family in the 1950s, where really most of the hymns we sang and so on were written in the 18th or 19th century and expressed the piety of Western world at the time, very much post-Reformation, but also retrieving some of the medieval theology, but a certain style of piety, which I honour, that's what formed me and shaped me. But the more I have read the Bible, the more I want to say that again and again those hymns and prayers and so on were actually buying into a Platonic spirituality, the idea of going to heaven so the earth doesn't really matter quite so much, etc., etc. And yet trying through that to retrieve what Luther and Calvin and Zwingli and the English reformers were doing. And again, I honour them because they were addressing the issues of their day and trying to do so biblically. The problem is that then people think we just have to go on repeating that and somehow that'll be all right. And through the 1950s and 1960s in my country, a lot of churches did that and were quite successful. But then today, in a postmodern, plural, global village, people are simply not thinking like that anymore. And we face huge problems about what to do about the Middle East, what to do about globalization, etc., etc. And the 16th and the 19th century are simply not helping us address those issues. But the first century could, because Paul was living in this multicultural, plural world with polytheism all over, etc., etc. And if we go back and understand what he was doing, then maybe the questions that we face in the 21st century, we might get fresh insights to help us there. And so the question is always, who is God calling us to be for our own day and for tomorrow, my grandchildren's world, and how can Scripture itself resources for that, rather than simply assuming that the reformers and others like them said everything that has to be said about the Scriptures?
Yes.
And I find that very exciting, a missiologically driven way of asking the question.
Thank you. And you recently published this book, which your friend Richard Hayes claimed as magnum opus, if I'm not wrong.
Magnum opus. It's clearly magnum.
And I noticed that Michael Bird, Australian scholar, and two of his friends recently published a book in response to your book here.
Yes.
And interestingly, what I noticed is they reversed the title, right? So your title here is Paul and Faithfulness of God. But their title is God and the Faithfulness of Paul.
Yes.
So what is your response to that book?
Well, you can read it because the book has, I think, 40 essays about this book, different aspects of it. And then they asked me if I would write a response to those essays. So I did. And what I did was I wrote a response about 15,000 words long. And they said, this is not long enough. You have not dealt with all the issues. So I then wrote some more, and my response is about 30,000 words. So the last chapter in that book, God and the Faithfulness of Paul, is a very long response by me. But the essays are quite different. They're coming at different angles and so on. And some of them, I think, have not fully understood what I was doing, so I'm trying to put that back together. Some of them have understood exactly what I'm doing and are saying, but you also need to do a bit of this and a bit of that. A very good essay by Greg Sterling, who's the Dean of the Divinity School at Yale, on Paul and philosophy, and he congratulates me for what I do on Paul and philosophy, but then says, we needed to have all the stuff about Middle Platonism, because I discussed the Stoics, the Epicureans, the Cynics, the early Platonists, but I hadn't gone into the Middle Platonism of Plutarch and Philo, and I wish I had, but the book would have been another 50 pages long. And then on one of the essays by Jörg Frey from Zurich, he attacks me because of what I say about apocalyptic, but in my response I show that he is thinking in terms of contemporary German scholarship on apocalyptic, not contemporary American scholarship on apocalyptic. And so I try to clarify that the word apocalyptic means several different things in contemporary discourse, and we have to isolate them and say, I'm in favour of these two, but not in favour of those two, and these two in the middle are muddled, or something like that. So, and several other things. Jack Leveson from Dallas has an essay about the Holy Spirit and what I do with the Spirit. And he points out that at a couple of places where I say, here Paul is making a radical innovation, actually there's a verse in Isaiah 63 and another verse in Haggai 2 where the Old Testament says what I say Paul says. And so, how did I miss that? So it's been really exciting, but there are some very poor essays actually in there where people have just not understood it at all. So it's a big book and people will have to read it for themselves. But it was, I was honoured. It's very exciting to have a whole book, 700 pages or so, about one's own work. That was wonderful.
Wow, thank you. So congratulations on this.
Thank you.
And on the Christian Origins and the Question of God series, so this is your
volume four.
So what will be your next volume?
It won't be for a while. I have a couple of other projects which I have to do before I can get back to it. The aim always was that then I would have a volume on the four Gospels, because volume two was Jesus and the victory of God, and obviously I'm drawing on the Gospels. But then that raises the question, if I am right in my description of Jesus and early Christianity, why then would Matthew, Mark, Luke and John want to tell the story of Jesus in the ways that they do? These are not the only ways they could have told the story of Jesus. So what are they trying to do? And why are they trying to do it? And the whole range of gospel scholarship over the last century and more has raised all kinds of issues and so on with Bultmann and his followers, and then other very different scholars, and now Richard Hayes' new book, Echoes of Scripture in the Gospels. And I want to let the dust settle on that for a bit, and then maybe in 3 or 4 years' time, there would be a book on the Gospels. Sooner or later, if I am able still in my 70s and who knows to write this, I would like to write a final volume on the New Testament and the mission of God, because it seems to me the New Testament is a missionary document. It's the document which resources the church as the church is engaged in the work of new creation. And I would like to do, it's not a New Testament theology. A New Testament theology ends up saying, here are all the true doctrines. Now, that's fine, true doctrines matter, but they matter because they resource the mission. And the mission is the thing that really matters, because we are new creation people.
Wow. That is exactly
it is. Now, it may be that I will either die before I can do that and somebody else will do it, but that's where I would like to be.
So when we talk about the mission of God, that is an exciting project. And we normally begin the mission of God with God's sending of Jesus Christ. Some people begin with God's calling of Noah. And some people begin the mission of God with God's calling of Abraham, especially Christopher Wright in his
God. Who is no relation, by the way. I know him, but we're not related.
Yeah, so what if we begin the mission of God with Genesis chapter 1? If we think of God's missions as participating in his creation care. What might be the problem?
I would be happy with that. In my own work, I have tended, like Chris Wright, to focus on Abraham particularly, because it seems to me that's how Genesis works. By Genesis 11 we have the Tower of Babel, and even after Noah being rescued, the human race is still in a mess. And then God says to Abraham, now in you all the families of the earth will be blessed. But then we notice, and some of the early Jewish commentators bring this out really well, that what God promises to Abraham echoes what God commanded to Adam. God says to Adam, be fruitful and multiply and look after the garden. God says to him, I will make you fruitful, I will multiply you, and I will give you the land. So the garden and the land, this is so the mission of God as we see it through the people of Israel, Abraham's family,
yes,
is the retrieval and the restatement of the original mission of Adam, which is creation care, which is culture, which is culture making, if you like, which is the creativity of image-bearing human beings.
Yes.
But it is now retrieved in a rescuing mode. That's why the Exodus is so important. Already in Genesis 15, God promises that Abraham's family will be rescued from Egypt.
Yes.
So they, because of sin, the fall, Cain, wickedness, arrogance, etc., the human race needs to be rescued from that in order that the original creational mandate of Genesis 1 and 2 can then be returned. And you see it in Revelation. The book of Revelation does not say that the Lamb has saved us by his blood so that we can go to heaven and rest forever. He says the Lamb has saved us by his blood in order that we might be the royal priesthood.
Mm-hmm.
And the royal priesthood is the retrieval of the original Adamic vocation.
Yes. Thank you. So, if we begin the mission of God with Genesis chapter 1, so can we also say that non-Christians are somehow participating in God's mission of creation care?
Yeah, well, the older theologians talked about common grace and saving grace,
yes,
and I think it's hugely important. Paul in Philippians doesn't say, keep yourself to yourselves because it's all wickedness out there. He says, whatever is true and lovely and noble and virtuous, if there's any virtue, any praise, think about these things, that God, in the wider world, has given humans gifts,
yes,
of music and art and so on. The trouble is that they twist it and distort it, but that doesn't mean there isn't goodness out there. But then he says, what you have learned and received and heard and seen in me,
yes,
this is what you have to do. In other words, there is an ethic which is very narrow, if you like. There is a new way of being human, but that new way actually doesn't mean you have to deny all the good things that people elsewhere do. So, you know, I have many non-Christian friends who care passionately about ecology, about justice,
yes,
about the poor, etc. And I say, of course they do, because they are made in God's image and they have an instinct for this.
Yes.
The problem is, if then, without Christ, they go about it in the wrong way.
Yes.
And the same way, you know, 15 years ago, whenever it was, where are we now, 14 years ago, with the Iraq War, Tony Blair was... A practicing Christian,
yes,
he really thought that the best thing to do about evil in the world was to go and drop bombs on it. And we should have known at the time, and a lot of us said at the time, that if we simply do this, we will generate a new generation of Islamic terrorists,
yes,
who will know that the Christian West drops bombs on us, because that's what they do. And so it has come to pass. We've learnt nothing. So that there is a real problem about when supposedly Christian people put into practice policies which, and I know that the global issues at the moment are very difficult, and I'm not,
yes,
saying I know the answers and they don't,
sure,
but a lot of people outside the church look at that and say there had to be a better way, and I want to say they were right, and the people inside the church were wrong, or some of them.
Yes.
So life is more complicated than we often make out.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. So what is your most favorite book in the New Testament and why?
That's very difficult. Somebody asked me this question a couple of years ago and I'd not really thought of it like that. And the answer that I gave then, I'll give to you, is that, you know, I have a lovely, rather odd house at home where I live. It's a rather strange house because it was put together from two or three little houses and it's rather strange. But in my house, the room where we spend a lot of time is the kitchen. It's very busy and we are always there, and I sometimes actually work at the kitchen table. The equivalent of the kitchen in my house in the New Testament is Galatians. There's everything going on there. It's very busy, it's very contested. There's stuff lying around the place, but it's very exciting. But then when we have guests, we take them through to a different room, which is a dining room, which is more spacious and leisurely. And it relates to the kitchen, but it's a different kind of room. That's Romans. And then there are other rooms as well, living rooms, which are basically, for me, the Gospels. But then at the back of our house, we have a deck, and we look out over the sea, over,
yes,
the North Sea, and you see the sun rising, and you see the sun setting.
Yes.
And that, for me, is the book of Revelation. This is the big, extraordinary picture. picture which is full of beauty and power. So I want to say, I don't want to be without any of these.
So your favorite books are Galatians?
Well, Galatians and Romans are where I sort of started as a New Testament theologian. But the Gospels are the living room. This is where we actually, here we are, and we enjoy being here, and the music of the Gospel is going on. But then there is this amazing view, and I'm not a Revelation scholar, but the Johannine literature, John's Gospel, and then Revelation, gives us this amazing, amazing view.
That's right. I think Richard Bauckham is one of.
Yeah. Bauckham has written a lot about the Johannine. I've learned a lot from him.
Exactly. And we still don't know who the author of Hebrew is. So, who is the author of Hebrew?
I don't think it's Paul. I think it's somebody who probably knows Paul's work and is tracking with him a bit. But we can't be sure of that. It might be somebody else who was contemporary with Paul and maybe knew about him a bit. But it is significantly different from Paul in style and in genre and so on. I mean, the great church father Origen said, nobody knows except God who wrote Hebrews.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, now let's talk a little bit about the Sermon on the Mount. Mm-hmm. What Jesus said in Sermon on the Mount is, if anyone slips on your right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. So this seems to be contradictory to the doctrine of retaliation in Exodus, right? Eye for eye, tooth for tooth. So what is the real purpose of the Sermon on the Mount?
Yeah, I mean, the Sermon on the Mount is the kingdom agenda for the people of God. Yes. It's Jesus saying, if you want to sign on with me, this is what we're about. We're a different sort of people through whom God is bringing about his kingdom. You have to start with the Beatitudes. Yeah. Blessed are the this and that and the other. But you notice with the Beatitudes, a lot of those blessings are on people through whom new things happen. Blessed are the merciful, for they will obtain mercy. And we have read them in terms of you've got to be a very special person to go to heaven, but that's not the point. It's God is doing what God is doing in the world through the mourners, the meek, the merciful, etc. And it's an agenda for how to be people through whom the love of God gets shed abroad in the world. And it's an eschatological vision because Jesus is saying, yes, you've heard that it was said to those of old time, an eye for an eye and tooth. You know, Jesus is setting himself in relation to the Torah and saying the full intention of Torah is now fulfilled, but the temporary dispensation of Torah is now put to one side. And you see this again and again in the Gospels, like when Jesus says about the divorce command, that yeah, Moses said you can do that because of the hardness of your hearts. But he says, now, we're going back to creation itself because we are new creation people. And so there is this dialectic between the real intention of Torah and the temporary dispensations of Torah. So within that, the vengeance quotation, clearly within the Torah, the eye for an eye for a tooth for a tooth is the limitation of vengeance. You know, if somebody gouges out my eye, I might be tempted to take out both of his eyes. And the Torah says, no, we understand you are going to need some sort of rough justice, but it must be only one for one, not two for one. And Jesus says, no, that's only a staging post on the way to the ultimate thing, which is a new way of being human, which is about love. And Walter Wink argued that when Jesus talked about being slapped on the right and the left, he said, if somebody slaps you on the right cheek, they're doing it with the back of their hand, which is demeaning. It is an insult as well as an injury. It is